welcome to On the Couch Conversations with Brenda. Today's guest is Don Axum.
Hi, thank you, Brenda. How are you?
I am fine. For those of you who do not know, Don is an choreographer, a dancer, an instructor, and she has won several awards, Albright Award and several others, Albright Scholar, sorry, and other awards. And Don, you and I met when we were considering working together on a show.
Yes.
Once on this island. And
Oh, wow. That's right.
Yes. I was so impressed with you as a person and your work that you sent me. I was sorry we didn't get a chance to work on that show together. I was so impressed. I was like, I have got to keep in touch with this lady. I love her and I love her work. So I'm still waiting for that opportunity for us to really truly work together. But since then, I've sort of been following. You've gone to Tri-Cities and you've worked at several projects and you have a company of your own.
Yes.
And I've seen some of your improvisational work with them and your work with your company, and now you're at Woodward. So I want to talk a little bit about, let's talk about your company.
Okay.
Okay. Tell me.
It's a company that I first did not know that I wanted. So it wasn't something that I sought out. And it's a company of professional choreographers and dancers. And the company is brought together with other storytellers. So from music storytellers, poets, writers, and visual artists. So I blend all of those cultures because I want a diverse effect when the company dances. So I like to blend mediums. I love blending mediums. And so I work with a variety of artists that are musicians, that are writers, that are producers of other forms of art, so alternative art. So I like doing that. And I bring dance into the fold of what their expertise is. So it's kind of like, if you think of, I like to encourage, explore, and experience through all those different cultures. So I'd like to do that through my first medium is dance. So I like to blend all of those things through dance. And actually I've gotten a lot into healing. So I'm doing a lot of meditation stuff with my company. And when I say the company is a baby company, and baby meaning I launched it 2013, but not launching it. Launching it meaning having a full-time job and doing it whenever I can. And so it wasn't really in a full swing. So it's slowly getting into the full swing, believe it or not, after 2013. Have lots of people that I've had to come through the company and that are still associated with the company. But it's a collaboration of those voices of professional artists as well as dancers, dancing being the main emphasis, that blend all of those cultures and mediums. I like to evoke some kind of emotion out of people. I think as an artist, if we don't evoke some kind of emotion, then we're not doing our job. And
yes.
So whether the emotion is like, I'm angry with you, I don't like that, okay. I caused you to have some kind of reaction. I think no reaction is what I don't want. So if I don't have a reaction, or people leave the show saying, oh, that was good, where do you want to go get something to eat? Then I'm like, oh. That means it meant nothing. It was like, oh, okay, that was cute. Cute is for our babies and puppies. Cute are babies and puppies, not art. So that's kind of how I view it.
So how does that work then? If I'm a visual artist or a jewelry maker or whatever, and I come to you and say, how can we collaborate? What do you do? Like, with an artist, or
okay.
I understand storytelling, I understand writing, but what do you do with
visual arts?
Yeah.
So visual arts or jewelry making. So the emphasis would be the collaboration of the two. So what I've done in the past, I've done a show called Camouflage, and I've done it twice. I've done it at Southwest Arts Center, and I did the first one though at the Maynard. I have to think of the visual arts gallery. It is no more. But they want to dance within the visual arts. So it kind of like emerges. So I said, well, can we paint the dancers and put it in front of the artists? And they were like, yeah, sure. We just want a dancer. And I said, well, what is the artwork that you want danced in front of? Let me see it. So when I saw it, I was like, well, where is this visual artist? And they were like, well, he's in Italy. And I was like, okay. So would he mind if a body was painted with his artwork on that body? And they were like, oh, that's a unique idea. And I was like, okay, can we do that? And they were like, yeah. And I was like, so it was my first time like trying it out. You're gonna ask, I don't want it to just be a dance. So, okay, that's good. But I want to, how can I blend those two together?
I
So
love
that's
that.
where it started. Brian Hebert, who was the visual artist director at Southwest Arts Center at the time, was the visual artist that painted for me. And it was actually, I was doing another show while he painted the dancer and they did the show. They videotaped it and everything. I was like, okay, great. They were like, well, then let's start this other thing. Brian is a visual artist. He was like, let's do something together, Dawn. I was like, okay. So then we did camouflage. We've done two. Haven't done them in years, but what the concept ideally was that the artist, you go into the gallery and the artwork is hanging, but the dancers are in front of the artwork, and so their bodies are painted with the artwork on it. And they're not moving. You just walk through the gallery and see them as they're painted. Then it goes from the gallery to the stage. So the dancers end up going to the stage. People that go, leave the gallery, they go to the stage, they go to the audience, they sit. Then the artwork is bigger on the screen and the dancers are dancing through it. So it was simple. So the artwork came first, then the dancers as painted in it, and then the music. So I chose the music based on what the artwork was. So a lot of people didn't show up, but it was okay. Who was there was meant to be there for that purpose to see it. And they enjoyed it. I was really pleased with it. And Brian was like, I was pleased with it because there were some hiccups, but the hiccups end up being things that I was like, okay, well, we'll keep this for the second one. The hiccup was the dancers weren't fully painted. So what I learned about visual artists is that they don't, they're very casual. They're very laid back. And so I was like, hey guys, can you guys come at 4 to paint the dancers so they could dry? Because the gallery is gonna open at 6. So the artists didn't come at 4. They weren't there at 5. They were there like 5:15. And I was
Oh my
like,
gosh. Oh, oh my
that was
gosh.
me. So they were there at 5:15. And I was like, can we start painting? And then they were painting the artists, and then people started coming in. So what I realized is that they liked seeing the artists painting the dancers. They liked that. They enjoyed seeing it. I wouldn't have thought that. I thought, was like, what? So they liked that. And so I was like, okay, I'll keep it. But the problem was the dancers weren't dry to go on stage. So the dancers were like, their bodies were still wet. So I was like, okay, we've got to dry them really quickly. So we had fans that we were trying to dry the paint on them. So so it was really funny. So then they got to the stage, they were dancing, and then one of the pieces looks like it blends together. And so the dancers were dancing together. So it's different artwork that was on the stage. But then their paint was blending with each other. So it ended up working out, but it was really, I was like, oh, okay, let's we'll revisit this and we'll do it a different way. And Brian was like, no, everyone loved seeing the artist paint. I said, well, I need some paint that's gonna dry faster. How about that? So tell me what that is. So then the second one was much better, but that's blending the visual arts. If you talk about jewelry, so the accent would maybe be whatever the jewelry would be. So if the jewelry is earrings, all of the accents and things that I would do would be about the earrings, or like I would kind of blend it with what the accent is, whatever I'm collaborating with, because that's the collaboration. I want to focus on what that artist is as well as the art of dance. So trying to blend those two, I think that's really important when you're talking about mixed mediums.
That's really interesting. So I
I
don't
hope
think
it's, I don't know if it's, if everybody might not think it's interesting. Some people might want to see like a straight, piece. And I'm like, that's cool too.
Yeah, that's cool. That's cool. Yeah. But that's one of the things I love about you is that you think outside of the box, and I love that. It excites me, and as a director, it excites me. As an audience member, it excites me. So, and then you work with young people, and I know that you are instilling in them that fire to bring in new and different ideas. You've worked with both Tri-Cities, and you're now at Woodward. That's
yes,
correct.
Yes. So I was at Tri-Cities for 20 years.
Was it that long? Oh my gosh.
I was a baby when
Five
I worked
years.
At Tri-Cities. 20. I was there for 20 years. Freddie Hendrix and I started the group that you see that's out. So you have the Christine Horn, you have Cy Gouge, you have Saikhon Simbla, you have David Cote, you have Neil Gant. So you have, those are the base of when we started Tri-Cities years ago. I then left, continued to do my master's, came back, and then brought back in, because I told Robert Connor, and I was like, who's a friend of mine who we worked together professionally outside of Tri-Cities before. And I said, I need you to come and teach. And he was like, no, I'm not teaching high school. And I was like, Rob, I need, come on. And so when he started, then he found a love for teaching. So I've been there through quite a few theater directors. And then it was a time that I was like, it's time to gracefully bow out, still have connections and ties to it. One of my company members, now presently, Brianna Bunkley, is the now new dance director of the school, of the dance department, which I'm really happy about. And one of my very good friends is the director of the magnet program. So her name is Dr. Mingo. But high school and even younger, I actually chose to do younger at Woodward because they had me my first year. This is going on my seventh year at Woodward.
Oh my gosh. Okay, they have 27 years altogether, and you're only 30. How did you do that?
That's right. How did I do that? Right. Yes, I'll claim that. Yeah, I'd rather be in my 30s than to be in my 20s, actually. Yes. So if I claim it, it'll be yes. I started young teaching, but I didn't start off wanting to teach. When I went to school, I went to just do choreography. And actually, my minor was child psychology and theater, which I didn't know how I was going to use child psychology. I just knew it was interesting to me. So, and a minor is just taking all your extra classes in that particular area. And so I did that. All my classes, any elective class was dealing with psychology and theater. That's my base of what I did when I was in school. But when at Tri-Cities, teaching high school and then transitioning, I stopped for a while and I freelanced for about 5 or 6 years. Was still teaching at Tri-Cities back and forth, taught at DeKalb School of the Arts for a minute, Georgia Perimeter College. I taught and went to Las Vegas to teach for Rob, because at that time then he was in Las Vegas Arts Academy. I taught in New Mexico for a different college there. So a variety of places that I went and did workshops and taught throughout the 5 to 6 years that I was freelancing. And then ended up at Woodward, and it was just by chance. One of my first grade best friends teaches at Woodward, Jenny Gould. So we've been friends since first grade. And she would say, I need for you to come and do a workshop for me. Knowing that I was freelance, I was like, not a problem. I'll come and do it. Her director at the time knew me from dancing with Lee Harper, who was over the dance department at Northside. So all of this is starting to blend. And she was like, hey, Dawn, can you come and teach a workshop with me as well in the upper school? And I was like, sure. She goes, oh, by the way, there's an opening at Woodward. And are you interested? And I was like, okay. Like, it wasn't like I was looking for it. I was like, sure, I'll do it. I'll fill out the application and see. She goes, they have someone in mind, but fill it out if you're interested. Okay, filled it out. So 2 weeks later, Marcia Spiller, who is now the head of Woodward, the She called me in for an interview and she goes, "You taught a workshop for me at the children's school." I was the principal there at the time. And I was like, "Oh, wow. Yeah, I remember that." I was like, "Wow." I said, I had just moved back to Atlanta. So things started to just move in that direction. I got the job and now I've been there literally. This is going into my 7th year. The president of what word? His name is Stuart Gulley, Dr. Stuart Gulley. I am so impressed with how he is managing the school. I'm really, really impressed. I'm his team. He found out about some of the things that all of the private schools had a private, I guess, Instagram account of alumni that had been racially discriminated against over the years. Like it goes back years. They are putting in blogs. All of the private schools, Pace, Woodward, Westminster, Lovett, all of these schools have like about 300 posts of alum and present students. He said he read Woodward's post and he was appalled. He said he will not ever, under his watch, have this happen again. Anyone that doesn't feel the same way, that they can leave the school. They don't have to be a part of Woodward. He is about changing the demographics as far, and Marcia Spiller, who is a black female, the first black female that is head of school, head of curriculum, she was starting to change the demographics of teachers there. So the reason why I work there is because they are making changes. They were the first to introduce a safe space and the LGBTQ, the community of transgender students being comfortable going to school there. They did all these workshops for the faculty. This was when I was there my 3rd year. So I was just impressed with that. I was like, oh, okay, that they are forward thinking. But he was so emphatic about our meeting with the entire faculty and staff. He was very, very forthcoming. He said, "I am appalled." He goes, "The N-word will never be mentioned on our campus in a song or in anything. And if it is, you will be dismissed from the school. You will not be a part of the school. It is not be, to be said by anyone." I don't think that he worded it so that if you choose to speak like that, then you may leave. You may leave. You can send me an email. You may leave. If you are not if you're not going forward with the principles that we are abiding by, you may go. As a teacher, as a student, he goes, that is not going to happen under my watch. Then he showed us a video. So if you haven't watched this video, I want you to watch it. An uncomfortable conversation with a black man.
I haven't.
I want you, okay. So I'm trying to see if I can. I watched seven when he showed it. So when you get off of this, if you can, an uncomfortable conversation with a black man, please watch it because it will change just how you think. Hold on. Emmanuel Acho, Acho. Emmanuel Acho is the host. He showed the first episode to the entire faculty over Zoom. Well, it was like a whole webcast. It was so intense and so amazing that it made me watch all of this man's. I'm up to the 7th episode. They're 10 minutes long. They're not long at all. But and some people will say, "Well, this is for white people." No, it was for all of us because he spoke so eloquently. He was just really open. But that this president of the school of majority white showed this to his entire faculty and staff was I was so impressed with it that he was like, "I stand behind this. You have conversations." They have diversity and inclusion group. We have them broken down now into each of the schools. Woodward has 5 schools. So
Five.
they have the upper school, which is 9th through 12th grade. They have the middle school, which is 7th and 8th grade. The lower school, where I teach, 4th through 6th grade. The primary school, which is pre-K through 3rd grade. And then they have North Campus, which is pre-K through 6th grade. North Campus is maybe Alpharetta. It's in Alpharetta. And then all the other campuses, they are kind of separate little, they're separate buildings, but that's all in College Park. But I had to say, I am so impressed with the president of Woodward Academy. Impressive. And teaching both high school and just younger people is it's refreshing. It's time consuming. It is, I guess the word is that, so I'm teaching them, but they're also teaching me. So I'm a life learner. So I feel that I'm learning so much from them because I'm not technically savvy. And so they teach me all the techniques of, no, that's what you're supposed to do there. No, Miss Axum, do it like this. Do, so I'm appreciative of all of that that they teach me. So I really, really enjoy teaching that, but I was supposed to teach high school and the lower school. So I'm teaching at the lower school because I love my principal. So when you have a leadership of someone that respects what you do, then you want to work in a different way for them. You don't like, it's not like, oh, I gotta go to work. It's more like, oh, right. And so what people don't realize is that to me, I've done high school. It's good. I still do workshops in the high school, but I was like, it's okay. I would prefer the little ones feed me a different kind of energy. And I teach the ages 9 through 12. So they're ranging in between that age, which is like lots of energy. During this pandemic, it's a lot. And so I'm usually drained and I'm like, okay, I've got to find some energy. But I enjoy the lessons that I learned from them, believe it or not, because they're innocent. They're still at that innocent age. I can teach younger. I prefer not to teach younger. I could teach older, like I can still teach middle school and high school. I like where I am. So I'm gonna
That's
stay there.
interesting.
I'm still growing. I'm still growing as a teacher. I feel like I'm still, when I stop growing, then I stop living. So I'm still like growing and doing what I love to do, as well as doing my company. I've come in contact with some amazing, amazing people, teachers, and students, either at Tri-Cities as well as at Woodward. And I know in one of your questions, it was like, well, what's the difference? The demo, like, one has money, one doesn't. Some, like, let's say children are children, and it's the parents actually that have a different expectation. That they're at a private school, the expectation is that you're at my beck and call. And so I'm a different kind of teacher. I'm like, no, I'm not. I am not at your beck and call. You can't just say, I need for you to do this. But guess what? Tri-City's parents told me the same thing, and they didn't have money. They were like, I need for you to put my daughter in this piece, and she needs to be the soloist. No, ma'am, that is not going to happen. Do you want to teach the class? You can. You want to teach it? You want to do that? So I just have it right. So believe it or not, they're very, 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 very slim differences. It might be money. And what you p depend on, how you want to spend your money. If you think about it like that, I had friends to tell me that they were like, I can't believe you let your daughters go to school that costs that much money. And they were friends of mine, they were cool. And I was no kind of way. They were like, you should have made them go to a school that was free. And I said, wow. I said, yeah, maybe. I said, but for me, I looked at it as an investment. Like that was that. For me, that was my investment. You might buy a Rolls Royce, or you might buy a high-end BMW, or you might, that's, it's okay. All during the time that they were in college, I didn't have a fancy car. I'm okay with that. The car, it wasn't my thing. But for others, that was important. So if it's okay with you, I'm good. If you like it, I love it. For me, I was fine. So that's, the differences are very minor. Minor differences.
Wow, that's interesting. I've had the opportunity to apply for or to be offered positions in teaching, and I've always said no, because I know that it's the full day, 7:30 to 3:30, and then it's rehearsals until 7 or 8 or 9, and then And it's like, where's my life? Number one. Number two, how do I do my art, which feeds me? So my question becomes to you, how, with you teaching for 27 years, how do you have time to even talk to your daughters?
They were with me 24/7. I just talked to one of the alumni of Tri-Cities, and she said, "You have it easy now. You don't have any children at home, and you don't have rehearsal after school." So it was funny. I used to live at Tri-Cities until midnight, maybe. The custodians would say, "Miss Axum, we're about to lock the building. We're about to lock you in."
Yes.
My
No.
kids would be with me, or they would be with my mother when she was living at the time. But I mean, it was a balance. It was something, you know, when you have like a burning desire to do something or a connection. And Freddie and I, or Rob and I, would be in the theater with them, or be working on a governor's honors piece, or working on a new work, or something. Always. And so it didn't seem like work, honestly. That's what I did. So if I wasn't working with them on it, then I was stepping outside of that and still working on my art, on creating and developing. It was just a burn. It was a burning kind of thing of wanting to do. You find time for those things that you want. So those relationships of that I connected with in when they were in high school, that are now grown children, married with children. One of my daughter's husband said to me, he was like, "So who are these people that came to this baby shower?" And I said, "Oh," I said, "That's my former student. That's his wife and his two children. That's my," and I said, "That was one of my former parents." I said, "I taught her daughter." And so he was like, he was looking, he goes, "You still stay in contact with them?" I was like, "Yeah." So I didn't know that I was going to stay in contact with them, but that's how this world has like weaved me through the 27 plus years of teaching.
That's wonderful. Now, you say you keep in touch, and I think that that's in today's society when, like I've taught workshops, and kids have given me their numbers. They want me to call them, and I've been very hesitant because I don't want any sort of problems to come up from me, having a relationship with a child,
Yes. How does that work, right?
Yes, how do you work
So
with that?
I am in contact with the parent constantly. I'm like, so my connection is with the child, but also with the parent. So they have to understand who I am. I'm very transparent. I'm like, here's my cell number, here's my email address. If you have any questions, if you want to come and check it out, even with younger kids that I work with now. I do the same thing with the parents. If you have any questions, give me a call or shoot me an email really quickly. I'll get back to you within 24 hours at least. But shoot me an email or text me and say, "Hey, I don't understand so and so and so." So I get that. I get that. I remember one of the rules when I was working at Tri-Cities. I guess something happened between a teacher and a student. So, and I don't. I there were probably lots of stuff that happened that I was not aware of. So they made Fulton County made a rule of if you're working individually with a student, your door must be open. You may not touch them. Like it was like a list of 10 things that you could and couldn't do. I was like, okay, that's fine. And so parents would come. I was like, "Well, if you want to come," I said, "I prefer you not to come and watch rehearsal because the child acts differently." I said, "Sit out, sit and wait if you want to wait." I feel that even in my teaching, even in school, even though they don't recommend this, I have an open door policy. So if you want to see what's going on and how I'm teaching, how I'm disciplining, I was like, "Come." I'm not going to say, "Oh, you need to make an appointment." No, I'm going to teach the same way whether you're there or whether the president is there or whether the principal is there. I'm going to teach the same way. Now, you might not like my teaching, but I'm going to teach my same way. So I'm going to reprimand. I'm going to be stern. I'm going to be loving, but I'm going to be, this is where we are. This is how we're going to have to work. I'm going to be very focused on what we're doing in class. And then the energy might change in class. So I've gone into class one day and I stopped. I didn't talk at all. And I was like, and I would clap my hands and I would do movement and they would look at me. And I was like, so the whole class I taught without talking at all, like no talking. But then they got it. They start to follow me. So I did this like about once or twice a week. I started doing it. And the kids, and I asked them after all of that was over, I said, so what did you learn? They were like, well, it made us a little bit more observant of what you were doing. I was like, oh, okay. And so it was a different just approach of teaching. And then I realized that I didn't know that that was an African way of teaching. That was a type of teaching that in Africa they've done quite a bit. And I was like, I just did it because I was tired of talking. There was no other way. I was tired of like talking a lot and saying, don't do that, stop this, da 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 da, scum, da da da. I was like, okay, I'm not gonna talk today. So that's literally like just coming up with creative ideas, the students feed me that. They feed that in me. Like, I like challenges of how can I reach that student? Like, what is it that I can reach? How can I reach them? So I didn't go into school. I didn't go to college for education. I ended up having to take educational classes, and I ended up taking them while I was teaching at Tri-Cities. So I had already had my undergraduate degree, but I needed education credits. So I took classes in education to get my educational degree, and I found out some horrible things that the number one reason for people to teach was to get summer vacations. I was like, that's horrible. That made me think of how then I taught, because I taught because I could, not because I wanted to. So then I was like, I said, wow, I need to be the kind of teacher that I want my children to have. I need to be that teacher because I want a teacher that wants to be there to help me grow. And it wasn't that I didn't want to help them grow, it was just that wasn't my focus. So when I started to shift my focus, my teaching started to change. So I realized that, but that was early on in my teaching because I was like, that's the number one reason. So my children are having teachers that only want a vacation. I was like, oh no, okay, I can't be that teacher. I can't be that teacher. So for me, it was like, let me readjust it because if a person's bringing their child, or even if it's an adult, who wants to be taught by someone who's like, okay, I'm doing you a favor? No, I want to be taught by someone that loves their job, that loves what they do. And that's why my company, I only want to work with people that love what they do. If they're like, oh, this is a chore, I'm like, that's okay. I'd rather you sit in the audience and watch and clap. You can support in that way. Don't come and take class with me then, because I want people that want to be there, basically.
So I was just about to ask you, what's the difference for you then with working with students and working with a
Adults don't, so students are very like, I'm here, I'm ready to open, except when they get to that stage where they feel that people are judging them. And that comes around 13, 12, might be a little bit earlier, where they think, I'm being judged. I can't show my true who I am.
Oh, and that
That's
drives me crazy because I've got to pull all of that from them. It's like you've got all that talent and it wears me out.
Yes, no, absolutely. But adults do the same thing. So it goes over. Yes, adults don't, they kind of like, unless you get to a certain age, I think you get to 45 and over, you're like, okay, you know what? What the hell? You know what? This is who I am. But I think at a certain, when you're a young adult, you're like, everyone's looking at me. What am I supposed like? It's like, girl, no one's looking at you. Let's go. Who cares? I find that boys excel a lot faster than girls in dance. Isn't that crazy? That's because guys don't care. They don't care what.
Oh.
Girls are so like, it's your leg is higher than mine. I need to get my leg up as high. Guys are like, let me just get my leg up. I have more guys that start dancing at 19, 20, 25 that surpass so many females that start dancing at five.
So you don't think it's about our body build or anything like that, or
You can
the
build your
muscles?
body. You could look at people like Missy Copeland. Her body is like beautiful, and she like exuberates that this is like such a drive and a hunger for her. So she excelled really fast, really, really fast in her life. But the build and the body, I think it starts with the mind. The mind is what tells you you can do this. And if you're so concerned about someone else, then you can't be focused on how you can excel in what you can do. So when I teach, I usually teach from the perspective of what are your natural abilities? I know you asked me about improvisation. So that's how I start improvisation. What do you do how do you move naturally? Do you flow or are you sharp? How do you flow? So let's create something on based on what your natural movement is and then enhance that with other things. So that's kind of how I kind of start improving with my company and how we end up building choreography. It's based on their natural abilities. And some of them, so I work with choreographers, dancers that are skilled and some that are just movers. I like just movers because they're not trying to be the perfect something. They're not trying to have a perfect leg up or a perfect. I was like, what's perfect? What is that? What I just want your best. So if your leg up going to second is great, then let me get it up all as far as you can go. Let's work on that. So I say that to say there is no perfect in dance. It's just what is your best? You can train, and the training meets through creativity, then you have beauty, like then you have so much. But if you don't have the wherewithal to stop the regiment of like this, because some people are like, no, it has to look like this. I said, okay, well then you can be a robot. You can look like that. That's great. I'm very organic when it comes to that because I think all individual people are different. I don't think we are all the same. And I think we have so many differences that we can showcase. Like we all have our different talents, whatever our talents are that we can showcase. So when it comes to dance, everybody has a dance, their own dance. It's the way they walk, the way they hold their body, so the gestures that they make. So I like building on individual people. So I've had to do that a lot with people that don't know how to dance, that say, I'm not a dancer. And then they do stuff like this. I'm not a dancer. I'm like, okay, but you're a mover. Let's work on that. Let's be comfortable in our bodies. So that's kind of how I blend the improvisation. And that's how I kind of teach. I teach, even though I teach the basic techniques. The technique is one thing, but you can be a technician and not be an artist at all. You could just be a technician and
That's
not be an artist. So I want to train them to, if they're not going to be an artist, to at least appreciate the artistry, to appreciate what it is to be a dancer, to be a singer, to be an actor, to appreciate that. So the techniques I think are amazing. But if you can't bring you to the technique, then you just have technique. I can teach anybody that. I can teach anybody a trick, but where is it coming from? So that's kind of the basis of how I'm teaching.
Now, your sister is also a dancer.
Yes, she's the one who
And
started me.
really?
Yes, I'm from a family of six. I am number six. Terry is number two. She's been dancing since she was young as well. My mother was a dancer. So my mother danced and was into singing and performing. She was very poor. She danced on the boardwalk in Daytona Beach, Florida. And she would dance because she wanted to get a milk. I know that sounds crazy, milk, because she only had goat milk when she came up. She didn't have regular milk. And goat milk is very thin, but they would ask to pay her. And she was young. She said she danced when she was 8 years old on the boardwalk. And she danced quite often, like on Saturdays or something. But sometimes they would feed her, but she just asked for milk.
Wow.
Crazy. But she danced, and she didn't pursue dancing, but my sister, Terry, who's my older sister, she danced and she was like, she said she wished for a sister that could dance. So when I came, number six, after five after her, so when I came, she stretched me, did all kinds of stuff with me. I lived with her for a year. when I was in seventh grade in Piscataway, New Jersey. I learned so much. I lived with her when she was at Princeton University and danced with her there with her company that she had there. And I was young, but I've been doing this for a long time. But yes, so we have sister companies. So our companies do, we blend together and we do quite a few things. And she has the technique, the Moja technique, that she's been working on for years. And we blend companies. So she uses some of my company members. I use some of hers. We travel and do things together. So we just traveled to the UK last November to do a workshop at the Regeneration, the One Dance Regeneration Dance Festival, where we taught Moja technique and we also did a performance called Sisters on their performance stage. That was last November at a
That must
festival.
be really neat to be able to have that collaboration with your blood sister.
It's not always easy. You know, just because you're relatives doesn't mean.
Especially with her being the older and you being the younger, yes.
It took her a while to say, okay, I'm going to listen to you, because otherwise it was like, I'm going to dictate to you. And I had to deal with that for a while. And I think now she's like, okay, you're an adult. And I was like, yeah, after two children married and two children later, okay, thank you. So, yes.
What project outside of the teaching are you working on now?
I was really honored to be asked to direct a one-woman show. We'll have a few people in the one-woman show, and I want to get the title right. Then They'll Tell You It's All in Your Head by Teresa Davis. So Teresa is a poet. She's a writer. Alice Lovelace is her mother. Teresa taught my children at Horizon School. So Teresa and I met. She was like, "Dawn, we met a long time ago." And I was like, "Really?" And so I didn't remember, but she taught my girls when they were at Horizon School. But I'm directing her one woman show. It will be aired in October 8th through 7 stages, and I'll start that in September. But my company is doing premiering our company works. I've not titled the works, but it'll be different choreographers for November 28th. That is the Saturday after Thanksgiving. So I'll be premiering a show then. It'll be very interesting. There's quite a few things that we're working on trying to explore during this pandemic. This has brought out, some good and bad in the work as artists. And I think reflection time was so needed. So I know that the pandemic is really like traumatic for so many families, people that have lost lives, and people that are infected with the virus. And I think that this is also a reflecting time on everybody of how we need to like stop for a minute, take a breath, slow down. And during this pandemic, that's what I started doing. And I realized, I was like, in that it is horrible, it has made me stop, breathe, and refocus where my energy needs to be. And I think it's been good for me and bad, but the bad is not overweighing the good. I'm making, my mom would say, you have lemons, you make lemonade, lemon pie, lemon, like whatever, lemon cookies, whatever. You make something out of what you get. That must be a black woman thing, because I'm sure most moms and grandmothers were like, this isn't going to happen. We're going to do it like this. So that was my mother. So in the stillness, I found more time to meditate, more time to actually look at us. We're communicating, and usually we're communicating in passing. Hey, Brenda, how are you doing? Like literally like this, ships passing. But so I think it's brought on a different kind of meaning to humanity and to people. So I'm looking at it in a positive. There are negatives, but if you know anything about the yin yang principle, there's you can't have one without the other. So I think something beautiful is gonna start to flourish out of this, but we needed to have this to happen. That's with all the riots. It needed to happen. Some one of my beige friends said, and She said, "So why now are the riots? Why during this time of George Floyd, and why now?" And I said, "So if you know anything about history, this isn't the first time the rioting has happened." I said, "But it's the first time it's happened like this." And I said, "Like this meaning in the entire world." I said, "So before they set a standard of how," and it's not even rioting. What did King say? People riot because they're not being heard. So if we say, "You're not treating us fairly. You're not treating us fairly. You are not treating us like," to that point, then that's where the riot comes out of despair, and that you don't hear me. You're not listening. And so to listen, I need to show you in a different way because you're not listening. You have tried to enslave us and continue to enslave us for years, and we don't have equality and we don't have equal. But what it's brought out is other means of how people of color have, like, we're gonna rise to the next occasion. Guess what? We're gonna do our own things. We're gonna support each other. We're gonna do this. So there's a beauty that has come out of this that I don't think would have come out of it before. So in the rioting, I told her, and then there are more cameras. People have video cameras. They can videotape stuff all the time. Before, they didn't have cameras like that they could videotape all of this. Now there's stuff that's like, no, we know what's happening. We're gonna say what's happening, and this is why. And
And we're going
so
to put it on social media for everyone to
we're
see.
gonna put it on social media for everyone to see, all over the world. That's the thing, all over the world, not just here in the United States, but in the entire world. Before the civil rights, that wasn't the entire world. That was just a certain part of the United States. But now we're talking, the world knows what's happening. Of course, we have leadership that is not, what would you say? Leading? How about that? Leadership that's not leading? Let me just put it like that. Not leading. And I think we needed to see that so that we could say, oh, what we had was great. Now we need to make things better, but it needed to come out in the public. It needed to be seen. And so, and that's why I employ everyone to vote. We got the rights as people of color to vote, and you don't vote? Vote.
I
Vote.
don't even care how you vote,
Vote.
just vote. Well, I would love, actually, I do care
Vote.
how you vote, but I'm not going to put that.
Right, but vote.
Vote. So, unfortunately, our time is up, and there's so much
Vote.
that we can talk about. Before we leave, is there something that you are burning to tell people?
Live in the moment. Be present. When you are present with people, be present in their presence. Talk to them, look at them in their face. Be in the moment. It will take you to many moments. Be in the moment.
I love it. Thank you so much, Dawn. I
You're
appreciate you
welcome,
taking your
Brenda.
time, and I am looking forward to one day us
Thank you for having
collaborating.
me.
Yes, you take care.
We will. We will.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye.
Bye.